also amazing. The real question is where do we go from here? The question politically is where do we go from here? But in terms of my point of view, sharing the process, where do we go from here? I said we'd take questions directly to the speakers now, and I think we should do that perhaps for 10 minutes and then consider how we go from here, because the proposal was that we break up into groups, into three groups. We are running short of time, so I'll take the mood of the meeting on that. We have an opportunity for a 10-15 minute coffee break. I think it would be most useful if we did briefly break into groups to look at the issue of how we can operationalise these amazing ideas, both in terms of an input into the, what we're supposed to be, input into the industrial strategy. I feel exactly the same as Steve when I looked at this document. You have a reference to the website, and it is extremely dispiriting to see a disconnected selection of pretty daft questions which are not framed in a way that encourage an input. So one thing we need to think about is maybe how do we make a better input into this, but secondly, how can we take some of these ideas practically into the local party, into our campaigning, into ways that because a lot of us have been trying to persuade, and gradually the idea is penetrating the skulls of some people in the Labour Party, that campaigning doesn't only mean knocking on doors and asking people which way they're going to vote, but it means street stalls, it means having literature about the NHS. How do we do the same job about industry, industrial policy, about the economy that we're already doing about the NHS? And I think the best way of, there isn't an answer out there that we just don't have because none of us has yet been clever enough to find it. We are the answer if we can put our ideas together. So I think what we can do most usefully, however briefly, even if it's only for 15 minutes, in smaller groups, each of them attached to one of the three speakers, but not run by the three speakers, but with people here coming forward with their ideas, and then we can have a final session where we bring them together. I think that's the best way of doing it. But first, there must be an opportunity for all of us to ask questions to and raise matters that have arisen from what we've heard. Chris?
Chris Bond, Aberdeen West. The first question to Steve is how we move forward, because having spent 40 plus years in the car industry in Calgary, I've seen the population there go from 28,000 in the 70s down to 4,500 now. And a lot of it is through, probably most of it is through technology, a little bit by productivity. And only recently, you know, we had a £700 million investment, which cost 200 jobs. And albeit the jobs weren't, it was done through natural wastage, it's still jobs that we've lost. And that was a very labour-intensive part of the plant. And now, the only place where the labour is high is in within assembly. The worrying thing now is that, and BMW are very, very good at innovating and developing automation. The worry now is that you've actually got robots that are working, although in its infancy, working opposite people doing actually line operators' jobs. It's, like I was saying, it's infancy, but you know, it will move very rapidly. And the other side of it, of course, is that, again, BMW are at the cutting edge of this, is carbon fibre. Because carbon fibre will do away with press shops, it'll do away with paint shops, and of course all the labour parts of the industry will go. And what do we do then? So how can we put that, you know, as a strategy within the party to move forward? And the other question is, totally agree with everything that Jenny said, but I mean, when we talk about procurement, we mustn't forget, of course, the motorcycles, because we have a wonderful factory just up the road in Hinckley that produce Triumphs. None of the police are using Triumphs. I remember the day when we used to see them on Velocettes and things like that, but now it's all BMWs. And it's wrong, you know, like Jenny said, you would never ever see a German policeman drive a British car, it would be a German produced car. And that's something that we really got to get home.
Thanks.
I'm
Sarah
Lindley. I
want
to ask a question about housing, because you've come to the home of the most expensive on average housing in the whole of the country, and it has a limit to the amount of space it can expand into, and it's taking all these people and developing a wonderful science lab, and, you know, it's doing all these things. We're going to be completely in the stuck with particularly transport, snarled up transport. But what I wanted to ask was, since in this town an enormous amount of potential disposable income is taken up by mortgages and rents, can you put that into the economic sort of situation, into an economic mix? And with that in mind, because to me it is, it's very much part of the industry. If you can't have industry, you can't find anywhere for your workers to live. So to me, it is absolutely part of industry. I think that we, as a Labour government, potential government, should look at controlling rents. Because they're an outrage. They're fired by estate agents now. Something was going to be done about estate agents, but I don't think it is now. They must have squeaked. So that's what I'm asking, is of rents, particularly. The rest of it's ghastly too.
Okay. Yes.
I'd like to make a comment that
we probably all know who you are, but you're not.
My name is Mark Adler, and until a couple of years ago, until a couple of years ago, I was the chair of the Joint Union Committee at the John Ratcliffe Hospital. And I'd like to take up one of Oscar's comments about how we sometimes understand productivity and so on. And in the discourse we have about social care and the NHS, these are seen almost as black holes that we pour money into. And it doesn't occur to us that these structures and these organisations are actually producing something. They're producing something which is so important, which is quite literally vital. We need it. We will die if we don't have these things. Yeah. And people will say, well, Apple produces things. They produce lovely computers and elegant tablets and things like that. And they say, the NHS doesn't produce anything. It just absorbs our money. Well, I'm afraid that isn't true. That is a wrong way of understanding how society works and what we need and what needs to be produced. So I want to go on a step further with that argument and say what we should be doing is we should be using the NHS and social services and so on, and actually using them to not merely provide wonderful services, but actually start to regenerate the economy on top of that. And there was an idea that was around some years ago about using the health service in particular as a superpower, a health to making us a health superpower, using the health service to regenerate the economy, in a sense. So when we've got this health service, it is producing a huge amount, but actually it is developing ideas and procedures and new machines and equipment, and we are producing the ideas, and often we are buying in these machines from all over the world to run our health service. Maybe the health service should actually be innovating and should be working with, ideally, the arms industry, to start producing new kidney machines, new scanners, and so on. Of course, you may have spotted a hidden agenda going on here, right, with our links that we're making. But obviously, the sort of engineers we've got in BMW, that it would be just so wonderful if we could say, right, let's actually use the NHS to drive the economy, to build new machinery, new equipment, new procedures. And you know, foreign manufacturers love using the NHS as a test bed. And the reason they like using the NHS is the NHS covers the whole population. It covers people whether you're black or white, whether you're poor or rich and so on. If something works in the NHS, it will work anywhere in the world because we have a comprehensive test bed, in a sense, with the NHS. So really, let's try and build ourselves into a health superpower. And I'd like to tick some of the boxes that they mentioned. They said, oh, we want our industrial policy to be diversified across the whole country. Well, NHS hospitals across the whole country. We want to be able to, you know, make the links with social media, to tick all these ridiculous boxes as well in the process. So, and of course, it is an overwhelmingly women's workforce as well, it begins to touch some of those questions. So let's help ourselves and help the world in the process.
Just take another round of... reaction from the speakers.
Okay, I'll answer two points to this. I mean, on the health thing, I mean, what I didn't mention in my talk earlier, but I was deeply disheartened by the beginning of the call for the consultation, because it said that not only what I said before about competitive and productive, but it said, true, and I quote, maintaining and building on our strengths, advanced manufacturing, automotive, aerospace, digital, biotech, and the cultural and creative industries. And I just thought, what about the health sector? What about the fact that we have one of the few world services that is still free? I mean, there are big, huge problems with it. Basically, around the issue that we spend 9% of our GDP, whereas our European partners spend an average 12% of their GDPs on the health service. It makes points that Osman was making about the need for investment. But actually, you're absolutely right. I mean, there could be so much done by actually saying that we have a strategy which is about fairness, which is about improving people's health, which is about a better society, without banging on about productivity. Although, on a very minor level, the issue of old age care, well, it's probably closer to me than most, many other people here. And I was discussing this because there are now human, well, robots that can do loads of things. And then someone said, well, actually, when I'm old, I would actually prefer to have a robot wiping my bum than a human being. You know, I think there's some type, but on the other hand, the empathy, the communication, the actual involvement, you know, I mean, so we may well find that the future, and not so far in the future, there will be a mixture of machines and so forth that will actually support old people in certain of their needs. Yeah. But you're still, the human need is absolutely essential. And that, again, is one of the answers to the notions about the balance between new technology and labour intensity. That is, we have better machines that we then use. I mean, it's like somebody coming to your house and putting your clothes into the washing machine because you can't bend down anymore. I mean, that sort of thing is actually, you know, definitely on the cards. The question on the car industry, much more difficult. I mean, the last time I was in, in fact, it was in the States, I was in a car plant, and I was absolutely staggered. I mean, I worked both in body and white, and then I worked on the assembly lines. And there were no longer any body in white. You know, they've virtually gone. I mean, very much smaller than they used to be. Assembly was still there. There were still human beings, but the cars were now turned. I mean, I used to work fitting lines on my back, working backwards like that as you fitted stuff underneath the car. Now the car is over on its side. You know, it's actually, you know, actual human. Now the robot can do that, there's no question. Those assembly jobs will disappear. But then how do we approach this? Do we approach it saying, well, we don't want the jobs to disappear? Well, actually, we want work to continue. We want decent, fulfilling jobs to remain. But actually, if technology can do these things, then let technology do them. I mean, as you probably all know, I mean, working, you know, sort of 7 hours a day, right, you know, it does actually. I mean, I only did it for 3 or 4 years, right? 10 years later, I got out into an academic job where I didn't have to, you know, beat my brains out, you know, I really feel tired at the end of the day. But, you know, it is something that is a contributing factor to backache as you get older and all the rest of these things. So, the issue of can we move, and then the question, what else happens? What other jobs are there? How are we working hours? Are we work sharing? I mean, one of the proposals, again, coming out from France is, and I'm not yet completely convinced about it, but it's interesting, the idea of a universal wage. That is that in a society in which there is going to be less work, we still do need to make sure that people have some sense of being a valued person of that society. Because at the moment, you know, if you're out, you're out. And and all the rights and all the capacities that you've got as somebody who's got a job might disappear the minute you don't. So we've got to think of ways of dealing with that. I mean, and the ownership, I mean, it is an issue, but, you know, I mean, we are in a global economy. What we have to do is to ensure that firms coming in, right, are actually responding to what we are saying, whether it's both, you know, the collective bargaining issues that Jenny raised earlier, but it's also about the good practices. I mean, we need to say the values of having fair work, fairness at work, right, must be applied by incoming investors, and that seems to me to be the way forward.
Great.
Do
you want to come back?
Oh yes.
Great.
Right. Now, I think the talk about the need for more public investment in NHS, in health, in social care is a very good question that then ties back to the challenge of automation, the fourth industrial revolution, and technological change. Now, in services, in NHS, very good example of that, we need actually lower productivity. We need lower output per worker, isn't it? We need more nurses taking care of fewer patients. Yeah. We need in social care more nursing labor taking care of fewer elderly people. So we need to decrease productivity there. Productivity as a buzzword is misleading. Services, in an orchestra, you can't have people playing cooker, isn't it? The whole symphony collapses. This is exactly like that. And Britain is very proud of having increased productivity in services. This is actually the same thing as we are very proud of deteriorating the quality of the services we are providing. If you put it in these words, everybody would understand how awful it is. But if you say you increase productivity, you feel like something good is happening. We need to demit such wrong statements. Now, so we need more people. We need more supply of these services, health services, but also more people supplying these services. Now, of course, if I say it to a unionized worker at BMW, similarly when I say to GMB members, well, we don't need to produce Trident, we will need these people to produce socially useful things, and part of that can be in social care, in health, say, oh, we do not want our members to do these bad jobs. Well, this is the wrong thing to say, because we want these jobs to become decent jobs, well-paid jobs, yeah, such that any blue-collar manufacturing worker can think that this is the kind of career I want for myself, how beautiful it is to work with people. I earn a decent living, I feel very useful at the end of the day as well. So surely I don't mind robots doing some of the repetitive tasks we are doing, but we need these people to feel secure that there will be something at the end of the day for them. And the other issue that we need to really discuss in the progressive movement is our deep centuries-old demand, shorter hours. Shorter hours with wage compensation. Now, productivity has always increased since Industrial Revolution, we know that. But one of the major gains of the labor movement is to fight for shorter hours in line with the rise in productivity, while we are trying to also increase our hourly pay rates. We managed that very well until the 80s, and since the 1980s, very little is happening in terms of further shortening. Now we're talking about 14th Industrial Revolution, that's an opportunity. We can work shorter hours. And I do wish to here challenge the quicker, seemingly easy fix around basic income or universal income. I want to contrast this for something that belongs to labor movement, that's the fight for full employment with decent pay, with shorter hours. We can do that. Well, I want to also drop one more thing, because this whole basic income, and Steve has now mentioned that Labour Party wanted to do a review around it. I'm very happy that it still hasn't done that, but I know everybody is thinking that as a magic silver bullet. It isn't. How high will the basic income be? Well, if it will be low, will it cover the needs? If it won't cover the needs of people, well, then we will have a lot of special needs for the unemployed, for the disabled. Then the silver bullet about its simplicity is disappearing. If it is high enough, how are we going to finance it, given that all the public investment needs we have been talking about? What we need is an economy that creates decent jobs for all men and women, and we can do it with short-termers. I mean, we don't have to be scared of robots. I didn't talk of the robots doing things that I wouldn't like humans to see, but I mean, surely there will be things that won't be robotized. We will arrive probably at an age where we will also talk about the rights of artificial intelligence. They will develop emotions. So we need to. There are a lot of things that we will need to think, trade unions organizing for robots as well. Surely basic income isn't something we need to be scared of. We don't need to talk or worry about robots. I wanted to write to people, workers and robots of the whole world unite.
I'm not going to answer those specific questions. And I have to say, I'm kind of thinking, how can I get out of being one of those groups? Because I'm going to be out with Steve with us and listen to more. And I can understand why, you know, Steve, why you might feel emotional, because I don't come to enough of these things. And hearing, you know, the fantastic ideas that we talked about gives me hope and think, yes, we can do this. I remember us talking about this, well, from the 70s and onwards, but we can do this. It's a real opportunity for us to do it. What I would say in terms of the actual consultation, don't feel obliged to answer the stupid questions. Just, you know, I think the feedback that's most important is, how can we develop an economy, and an industrial strategy that works, and it's meaningful and realistic? I'll be completely honest, I put my hand up, and I should have read this, because I'm not just a member of the Policy Commission on for the Economy, but co-convening it, I haven't read it. I haven't read the consultation document, and I'm quite glad I haven't. Yeah, I just haven't had time to do it. So I think it's the key answers, and if you try and sort of answer the questions in the way that they are, we're not going to get a proper sort of like holistic view of what things should look like. And it's clear that we need to have much more discussion. I am very ignorant about the, you know, some of the energy stuff, you know, and I would like us to have that as a really key part of you know, this response, so that we really do look at every element of what we should be talking about. So I don't think you've got to answer that. I think certainly, as well in terms of evidence, I'm going to be pushing strongly. I know that, you know, I'm sure you both know John very well, but we need to kind of get people like Steve and Oslin giving evidence to the Policy Commission as well, again and again and again. So even if you've done it before, to kind of get you to do it again, so we keep these ideas out there and show they're real and not sort of pie in the sky, theoretical, sort of odd lefty ideas. They're real and achievable.
Okay. We can have street stalls, we can have leaflets, we can have campaigns about the NHS, and people know what we're talking about. How do we get the confidence and the clarity of ideas to be able to do the same thing about the topics that we've been hearing from our speakers and more generally today? So, without any ado, if anybody wants to start by kicking off on that, and if they don't, I will abuse my position as chair just to talk about the co-op, because the is it the Birmingham Midshires Co-op, is our local co-op, they have a policy of not closing co-ops where they're the co-op branches, if they're the only co-op branch in a village or a housing estate, they will keep it open as long as it's not actually losing money, as long as it's making any money at all, it's not actually losing money. And how does that differ from what a privately owned, profit-maximising supermarket like Tesco's or Sainsbury's would do? They aim to make a target rate of return. They would look at the money they've got tied up and they might say, we could sell that site for £500,000, and if we invested that £500,000 somewhere else, we'd make a higher rate of profit. Maybe they're only making 5% return on the money we've got tied up there, but if we invested it somewhere else, we'd make 10%. So we'll close that one and shift it somewhere else. The co-op operates on a different basis, and as long as it's paying its way, yes, you've got to be realistic, as long as it's paying its way, they say, is it providing service? And I think in a microcosm, that's very instructive. And the Greater London Council and the Greater London Enterprise Board, which I had the exciting privilege of working for in the days of the GLC, operated on that principle. It said, yes, we have
a pot of public money. We want to steward it responsibly. We're not going to pump money into propping up lame ducks. But if we have an investment proposition that comes to us and it looks like paying its way, then we won't go for the maximum return, but we will look for a social return. And there was actually a methodology worked out. How much additional weighting do you give for the fact that this investment proposition will advance our objectives of equal opportunities, of industrial democracy, of environmental sustainability? And that was the methodology that was used. In order to popularize that idea, you had to have an institution, of a democratic institution, in that case the Greater London Council. And when that was abolished, and when things like regional enterprise boards were abolished, and when you don't have things like regional investment banks, then there is a gap in the imagination, which makes it so much harder to put across on the doorstep, if you like, in mass propaganda, the sort of ideas that have been developed here. People say, oh, we need regional investment banks. But what is a regional investment bank? Show me one. We may have an idea, but our neighbours, our workmates, somebody bump into the street, wouldn't know a regional investment bank from the back of a bus. When they exist, you can put demands on them. And that's one of the problems, I'll just mention it, one of the problems that we have in connecting the ideas we've had today, which do point the way to a different society, and actually convincing them. And that's why it was part, and it still is part, of the strategy of reactionaries of all kinds to close down the public space, and close down public democratic debate, and close down, squash, destroy institutions that make you think, or enable you to think, about how things could be different. Anyway, that's my rant.
I'm Rod Steele. I'm a member of the co-op, and I agree with the point you're making, particularly in relation to Great London Enterprise Board, Industrial Democracy, or whatever. There are other stories that could tell about the co-op, which tie in with, say, the housing situation in Oxford. They've reacted well, is all I can say. Right?
Reacted?
So, that they reacted well to some of the initiative, some of the stuff which is ongoing.
Yeah.
But the point about the co-op is that it's supposedly a member-led organisation, so democratic in that sense. It's supposedly a consumer cooperative. I can assure you it's a big business, and there's all sorts of problems.
Oh, sure.
The point I'm going to make is the attack. The one Oxfordshire thing, right, is an attempt to impose worse things upon us, right? We're not talking about defending the city quo as in the city council. We're talking about, we should be talking about, creating a new kind of democracy, right? One of the things I'm really passionate about is, and this applies to United Community in particular, that we are out there in the community, as Jeremy said, asking them about housing, for example, listening to them, learning from them, but also getting the strength of the Unite and the organised trade union. Yes, exactly. That's what we're trying. Yeah, that's what we're trying to do. On Tuesday, it's the end of Love Unions Week. We have a regional store. It's not a car. That's what we've done before. It's a nearby hotel, and there's good reasons for that, which I can't go into. But on Saturday, we're going to Rose Hill to continue our campaign, getting into the communities, in this case, mainly after the housing. There might be other things to come up as well. But that is an example of how things that we used to call the two wings of the Labour movement can be working, but can be out there and selling the message.
Yes, what an exciting morning, and what I want to do more than anything else is to focus on how we get this out into what we represent, which is the local Labour Party.
Again, we know who you are.
Sorry, Liz Perrotts, I'm in the Labour Party locally. I'm also Southwest. I don't know about it. I think that we should pick up a couple, two or three ideas, well, a lot of ideas.
Can everybody hear?
Chuck, do you want me to stand up? I think that there are a lot of ideas here that we need to take out and take onto stalls, into Labour Party newsletters, and ourselves kind of develop them. I mean, there are some key things, like we should have a principled stand. I think it was you that said the principled stand should be, everything should be against the litmus test of full employment, equality, and ecological sustainability. Sorry, was that
awesome? I'm shaking, can't
all three of you.
Being able to also the same.
And I think we should keep saying that. We should keep also pushing it. What is productivity? Because for me, if I've got somebody, as I have had, at home needing home care, productivity doesn't mean how quickly are they in or out. It means the human interaction. It means the love, the relationship that I heard. There was a fantastic talk recently about the NHS, which was in a joint health overview in Swinton, where one of the members of Keep Our NHS Public, who's also in the Labour Party, said buildings, they're trying to close hospitals. What people don't understand is those hospitals and those health service places are full of joy and hope, and those things, the production of joy and hope is every bit as important as so we need to take those principles and those ideas and the fantastically sound evidence-based work that the women's budget group have come up with, which shows if you actually put money into health and social care, basically, you get out of it a hugely more vibrant, more equal, more ecologically sound, altogether a better society than we have. We can get that out there if we, for instance, to take up the idea of a survey, we put a survey in our newsletters, we put a petition or some things on stalls. We get a conversation going in every branch of our Labour Party. We take it out to the community associations. And I think we should charge a small group from here to do that. So that is my suggestion.
One of the things that I was... Sorry, my voice is not good, my back's bad. One of the things I was thinking of was we want to be liaising, connecting with the voluntary groups out there.
Yeah.
Because I think that's an important vehicle for us to get our message out.
Can you give your name?
Sorry, I'm Sylvia Howells. I'm a member of the Bristol Labour Party.
Right.
I'm also a social worker.
I'm Rosemary Preston. I thoroughly enjoyed the morning. And I was pleased to hear about taboo terms. And it seems to me we should have a vocabulary list. Because I hadn't quite clicked monetary was taboo, and whatever the other one was that you mentioned. But along with them, I like closing down institutions that make us think, absolutely. But for a long time, we've known about deprofessionalisation. The proportion of people in quasi-academic employment on fixed-term contracts for months or a small number of years, moving between towns to deliver the same stuff in history, physics, or whatever, it's stultifying. We are in danger of letting the Labour Party rhetoric roll over us that it's the middle classes talking about doing good for the blue-collar workers. Everybody's in the same mess. And I think we have to say, how do we redress the whole structure? We have heard the words, but we've got to be very precise as to how we do it. A word that I have yet to hear in the Oxford Labour Party is precariat. And it's shameful that it is silenced. We have to get it out there. It's across the country, and it's not going to go away unless it's looked at between the eyes and action is taken to address it.
Yep.
Thank you, Phil. I just wanted to follow up from my first group just said, and maybe broaden it out a little bit, because one of the key kind of concepts in the sense that we haven't discussed so far in this morning in relation to industrial strategy is that risk. And I would tentatively kind of add one thing to Osman's list of three kinds of things that we judge everything about or against, as well as the ecological sustainability, equality and full employment. I would also say security for people. And one of the key things that I think we need in a just society is a secure working life for everybody. Now, precariat concept and the kind of work that Rosemary talked about is one extreme element of that, but we've also seen Tory and New Labour industrial strategy leading to huge transfers of risk within our society over the last 20 or 30 years. The two biggest ones, I think, within the NHS, the whole impact of the private finance initiative, massive transfer of risk from the public sector to the private sector, with absolutely horrendous consequences. The second one is in pensions, where there's been a huge transfer of risk from capital to labour, workers have had to bear the risk of effectively the increase, or the risk posed to capital by the ageing of the population. So one of the key things I think we need to do, and this could go back to the doorstep, is to integrate safety and security for people in terms of their incomes and the other kinds of issues that you face during the working lives, our working lives, and our home lives as well, into the core of an industrial strategy. Now, how to do that, just one thing very quickly on this, there is a huge kind of engine, if you like, for dealing with risk that has been created in the last 30 years in the financial sector by capital. It's not well understood by the majority of the population. It's highly technical and sophisticated. It is actually very effective, but it's only used for the rich and the powerful. So the rich and powerful have been able to manage their risks very, very effectively through the derivatives and new kinds of financial contracts that have been created. Large companies and multinationals have been able to do this. The broad mass of the population have not. And I think one of the key issues for the future is taking that knowledge about the management of risk and bringing that out of that small kind of sector of people who have been given this incredible privilege in terms of something so central, and bringing that into the mass of the population.
I should say, I'm always a bit puzzled when people talk about precariat as something new. It's not an innovation, it's going backwards. So we all remember reading about the old days when dock workers had to jostle and elbow each other at the gate to catch the eye of the foreman. You can work, you can have a day's work, you can have a day's work. And we thought those bad days had gone, the dockers' strike in the 1880s, but they're coming back. Yeah.
Oxford East. Just public clarification. I understand that the deadline for the end of this consultation is not far away.
Yeah.
Are we not jumping the gun here? Because we need to sort of, before going out campaigning, we didn't know quite what industrial strategy we're campaigning on. Certain questions have been raised about the document so far, which to me is slightly alarming, because the time is not on our side. I mean, the election could be called this year, for instance, and we need to be clear about the strategy. What I was going to say is that we need definitely to obviously clarify everybody within the Labour Party and the trade union about what that strategy is, and then when this document should be discussed at every Labour Party branch, every meeting, every trade union branch, every trade union that's affiliated to the Labour Party, and get responses to that within the consultation if it's the deadline, if at all possible. But broadly, to sort of say, well, you know, this is our future here, and we need a definite picture of where Labour and future Labour government is going to go, because it's going to face enormous problems. We know that.
Right. Well, we're very lucky that Jenny is here, because she's co-convener of the working group that's running this procedure. So maybe
Jenny. I'll ask that at the end.
All right. Fine.
Yeah. Sorry, my name's Steve Simon, BDW and ever still in Parliament. We've got a board. I
can't hear you.
Speak up.
Yeah,
we've got
sorry about that.
I was hoping that I'd be able to sneak out and it would be packed, but we've got a board, so it's just to say thank you to the panelists. It's been absolutely brilliant. We will discuss it in the branch.
Great.
And we can report back to the Labour Party.
That would be wonderful.
And to the chairman. Thank you very much.
Kathy, here. So your hand, you're quite right, yes. Yeah.
James from Banyan Vista Security. I'd like to appreciate the emphasis of two of the speakers, Oswald and Steve, on the importance of values of the labour movement as opposed to productivity in the policy document. It reminds me of when I looked at the first draft of the party's policy for education, because I have a background in education, before the 2015 election, and was really horrified for exactly the same reason, that this draft policy started by presenting the major task as being one of improving the country's competitiveness in the international economy. And it said nothing at all about the values that education should be developing, the importance of social cohesion and integration, this kind of thing, which are much closer to the real goals that educationists would think about. And so this says that we need to have a consistency between what the party develops as its industrial strategy and its policies in other areas, such as education. The education policy should be complementary to the industrial one. If I can abuse my being on my feet, I would be interested, and this is a different issue, I would be interested in what the speakers think about how the Copenhagen by-election should be handled. Because it looks as though the party is about to be caught in its pants down without having a proper industrial strategy developed. What is the official line on Sellafield? Is the party going to fudge it? Is it going to adopt a principal position? Or what is going to happen, and what should happen?
Thanks. Kathy, can you be very, very brief? Or
indeed. Kathy, you're just in the community and the co-branch of Montage CLP. Just two quick questions, really, practical questions. When this was advertised, Clive Lewis was one of the sponsors, and I wondered if he would now be replaced by Rebecca Longbody.
Yes. She has been. Yes.
And the other point was, there is the Workplace 2020 initiative that is gathering lots of information through discussions and a web page, and may overlap with a lot of what we're talking about. So I wondered how they might be woven together.
Yeah, for sure. Okay.
I think there's quite a lot of information going through that other program.
Thanks. And very brief.
Yeah, and I'm Dr. Lee. It's just that I tend to be not so good at speaking, but can sometimes do things better visually. And I think if we could actually have a visual diagram of how we see the core values of the party, and then spreading out to all these different areas, the infrastructure, etc. And I think that would perhaps be a good way of getting just one, one diagram, perhaps followed by a few other things, which would get it across to people in a simple fashion.
Now, I'm afraid we've run out of time. We've just got to have brief summings up from the speakers.
Okay, yeah, I'll ask a couple of things. In terms of what we campaign on, I think it's very clear that there are already a whole number of areas where we can campaign on because they are almost taken to bed by the teams that are working on this. So things like, you know, public procurement and so on. But I think also the issues of redefining what is infrastructure in the way that Oslo talked about, you know, it's our infrastructure, it's the building blocks of our society. So, but it's not just the physical building blocks, it's got to be all of the other things we talked about, social care, and I would say education is absolutely integral in industry. It can't be complementary. If we don't have, you know, all of those things in our building blocks, we're not going to have the kind of society that we need, we're not going to have, you know, the productivity and everything else. I'm not even going to go there with coping because I see we've got about 5 minutes to answer all these questions, but I think it's a very good question. But I think just in terms of what we campaign on, we know, for example, you know, taxation, that's a key issue. I don't think we explain that enough to people. People don't understand how little tax people pay. We had a dispute over pensions in Gatwick Airport Limited. They hadn't paid any tax since they bought Gatwick Airport in 2009. Not a penny, and it's all in the Cayman Islands and offshore. People don't know that. You know, millions of people go through Gatwick every year. If you talk to people and say, is it right they don't pay tax, and by the way, your mum gets 15 minutes of care on a Tuesday if she's lucky and it's a different person every week, they start to kind of join the dots and think, actually, it's not so complicated and perhaps I can understand it. Yeah. So I think there's a lot of things we can campaign on now, although I agree that we do need to get this document up and out there. In terms of Workplace 2020, the Industrial Strategy Consultation is actually separate to the Economy Policy Commission, and so is Workplace 2020, but at the last Policy Commission, I said we kind of need to look at how we bring all those together and then we have joint meetings of the three bodies so we can have an overall view. Because housing is another separate one as well. All of these have threads that run together. So we've just got to look at imaginatively how we bring everything together. But I think the more events we have like this to get that with different audiences to get out to people, but also all the sorts of things that you were talking about just now, are massively important. You know, let's get ideas in bite-sized chunks out to people, out to trade unions, out to communities, people on the street. You know, they're the ones who are going to make a difference. I love everything you talked about the NHS, but we haven't got time to talk about it now. But you know, it's a superpower. NHS is a superpower. Brilliant.
Steve. Yes, I mean, the only thing that I would probably add to what I was saying before was that, yes, risk, Andrew mentioned it, is a critical thing. And it's happening not just, as we've seen, with the shift of public goods into the private sector, right, which is one part of it, but it's also the shift towards individual lives. And that really is I think where we can make a really strong positive response from Labour. The social objectives that we have to say are our values and we must work around. I mean, it obviously include housing. I mean, the whole issue of housing and the restrictions that the government has got on local authority council house buying, the immediate right to buy, and these things that have got to be flagged up as being wrong. I mean, we've got to have public housing. We've got to have rent controls. I mean, first time in my life, not first time, but I mean, after the last 4 years, I'm now living in a rented flat, and the landlord each year comes out and says, I want to increase the rent. It begins to get nervous when you're on a fixed income, you know, how far can this go on before, you know, I have to probably downsize, get out, you know, do whatever I can do. Housing, definitely. Health, definitely. And health and social care. Equalities, right, across the board, and sustainability. I mean, the issue of saying, that's where we're going. We are going to produce, as far as Britain can, right, an economy that is not contributing towards the global warming, and we're working with other Europeans, we're working with other people in the rest of the world. I think the international dimension can't be ignored, because if we ignore that, then we are turning ourselves into a kind of, you know, a Britain-UK. We can't ignore it. The only solutions to these bigger problems are on a much, much wider scale. Yeah.
Thanks. Awesome.
Yes, I think what Brexit taught us is we need to understand people's anxieties and give them the security that we have a long-term vision to tackle their problems in the here and now, as well as in the long term. And it brings me to the Copland and the power plant question. It's the same with Trident. I mean, I would be very, very, very worried if somebody came to me and said, well, we don't anymore need this working class university at Greenwich, we're going to shut it down. I mean, obviously, I would be very worried, and there are people telling us that. You don't anymore need your universities, there will be online teaching, well, robots replacing me. I feel very worried about that. So I would like to see what is next. So if you're not supporting nuclear power plant, if you're not going to renew Trident, what is next for me? We need to understand this. There are solutions to that. There are short-term fixes to the problems and long-term transitional solutions to the problems. We can't just say that in the long run there would be ecological renewable energy, tidal power, and your granddaughter and son will be working there. These people want their job now and the same type of high-quality job. We need to be able to talk about this, but we also need to be brave. We can't try to be too pragmatic to fix a solution in the short run on the wrong values either. It also, I think, damages the trust in our society to what the Labour Party is representing. I mean, you can't give a message, a different message in Westminster and a different message in one local constituency. It's also people are very clever. They're noticing this immediately. I mean, there is a good reason why I'm not a politician. I wouldn't be good in doing all these, but the solutions, the technical solutions, we know these. We need to be a bit more brave, self-confident, and yes, start here and in the here and now. Now we will diversify away from nuclear power from today on, and we will diversify our defense strategy away from nuclear weapons. Starting from today, industrial policy is so important. But we need to tell these people there will be transitionary situations where we will secure your income, but we will secure the collective voice you have until you get re-employed in a unit that produces decent goods and services worthy of your skills. And this transition wouldn't take actually years. It would take months. It is not something, if Labour was in power, using all the tools of financing that we know about, as economists at least, it would take months to redeploy these people in decent comparable jobs. And we know how to deal with transitionary things. Nobody should lose any income. Nobody should lose dignity. I suppose we can stand behind these values. We just have to really be consistent and brave.
Thanks. Sellafield, as a processing plant, the people who work there actually have the safest jobs in the country, because if you took a decision to phase out nuclear power today, you don't close a nuclear power station by turning off the switch on a Friday and having McAlpine come in with a ball and chain on a Monday to smash it. You take it apart very carefully over a long period, and you send all the nasty bits up to Sellafield to be processed. So actually, the guys at Sellafield have safe jobs for the next 20 years, which is more than anybody else can say.
It's not safe pensions.
Not safe. Wow, that was next 2,000. Yeah, next 2,000. However, getting that across is another matter. This has been fantastic. I think Liz's proposal that we keep in touch with people who want to keep going as a working group on this to come up with workable proposals to take for the party is fantastic. With those who are interested in taking part, we have a clipboard at the back. If somebody would like to put themselves in charge of that clipboard, and people who want to be kept in touch on this could give their names and contact details, we will do that. We have to be out of here very soon. Thank you all so much for coming. In particular, thanks to our fantastic speakers who have given us more ideas than we can cope with in the short run. But we'll be in touch with them and we'll be feeding stuff back. The official closing date for the consultation is the 16th, isn't it? Is it apparently? Yes. According to the document. which of course is ridiculous. But I'm sure that our speakers and others will be making the sorts of points that you've heard. If an individual who wants to, don't be intimidated by this ludicrous document, but make some common sense points and send them in. And when a document does come out, we can have further consultation and, as has been suggested, ensure that it's discussed in all branches of the party and of affiliated unions and other organisations, so that we can take at least some of the ideas, hopefully some of them will be of some use, and discover a way of making them common sense. Thank you all very much. Keep in touch, and a fantastic thank you to our speakers.